Very warm welcome to you all, and I'll remember to welcome those who might be watching from home, online, or watching a recording. Welcome to you too. Gosh, well, the rain this morning was biblical, wasn't it? Glad that stopped before the service started. And we'll try to get the service to flow, but I do have to announce one or two hymns because we're leaving some verses out, including a verse of the first hymn, which is hymn 211. We're omitting verse 3. So let's stand while I welcome you formally, and then we'll sing our first hymn. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hymn 211, omitting verse 3. To whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We confess together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our name, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own dearly fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is wrong. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. He sent the Holy Spirit upon your church in the burning fire of your love. Grant that your people may be fervent in the fellowship of the gospel, that always abiding in you, they may be found steadfast in faith and active in service. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please have a seat for our readings.
First reading is from the book of Exodus, chapter 14, starting at verse 19. The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel, so that the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth, and the Egyptians fled before it. The Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea, the waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading from the New Testament is taken from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. This is a reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. "Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day observe it in honour of the Lord, and those who eat eat in honour of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain abstain in honour of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, 'As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God.' So then, each of us will be accountable to God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from the heart. This is the Gospel of the Lord. May my words and our thoughts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. Please have a seat. So first I'll take you back to the first reading, that amazing reading about the Israelites escaping the Egyptians who came to a very sticky end, certainly a very wet end. Some of us might have thought about that at 4:30, 5 o'clock this morning. It's one of those stories we learn at a very early age, along with Noah and the Ark. But like many of these ancient stories or myths, if we dig deep in a literal way, we can uncover a God who many would rightly not want to believe in. A God who wipes out all life on the planet to start again, or a God who drowns an entire army, which, like all armies, is made up of brothers and parents and children. This is not, fortunately, the God we hear reflected in Jesus' words to us in the Gospel. Otherwise, God does not seem to be setting much of an example in how to forgive in the reading from Exodus. So we turn to the Gospels and we read the passage in light of the evidence of a God who passionately is concerned for and forgives and loves all people. Then we can hopefully learn the real significance of that first reading and see in Exodus, for example, as a story, a metaphor for the liberation and the triumph of the oppressed over their oppressors. It symbolizes the idea that even in the face of overwhelming odds, God's justice can prevail. It's the sort of odds experienced by black people in South Africa during the apartheid era, or perhaps by those who still suffer as a result of a number of different characteristics, which are and have been discriminated against over the centuries. Over a weekend when people here in Jersey are celebrating a more progressive, enlightened attitude towards sexuality and sexual orientation, this is something to rejoice in. Then in our reading from Romans, our second reading, Paul emphasizes the importance of accepting and not passing judgment on fellow believers who may hold different opinions or practices, reminds us that within the Christian community, across the wide spectrum of denominations, there can be an enormous diversity of beliefs and practices. And this diversity should be met with tolerance and understanding. A recent conversation about holy baptism was a reminder to me to realise that different churches' policies, and the Salvation Army's denomination doesn't even have baptism. I'm off after this service to join with a Salvation Army officer to lead a service at a memorial for the Forgotten Army. It is love that's highlighted by Paul as the guiding principle in dealing with these differences we have across the Christian community. We are encouraged to prioritise love for one another over personal preferences and convictions, because love seeks the well-being and the unity of the whole community. The passage advises us to avoid being a stumbling block to others, which means being sensitive to the consciences of our fellow believers and refraining from actions that might lead them to go against their own convictions. It calls for a level of selflessness in our interactions, and really is just about being sensitive towards one another. Paul encourages mutual accountability among believers. While we should not judge one another, we can gently and lovingly counsel and support each other in our faith journeys, fostering a sense of community and growth. Paul's words from Romans remind us that unity in the Christian community does not mean uniformity. It is possible to have unity amidst diversity when love, acceptance, and the pursuit of Christ's teachings are at the centre of our relationships. He challenges us to prioritise the well-being of our fellow believers and the unity of the body of Christ above our own preferences and convictions. And our gospel backs all of this up, but by focusing on forgiveness. Not seven, but 77 times we are to forgive. But this effectively means an endless amount of times to forgive, and we shouldn't be keeping count. I came across C.S. Lewis's interpretation of this reading and was impressed by it, so I thought I'd share it with you this morning, just to finish with, really. He reflects that it may be that we don't have to forgive 77 separate offences, but that it may in fact take us 77 attempts to forgive someone fully, even just once. So we forgive and we say, I've let it go. But then that night, we remember the offence again. And it rankles, it gets under our skin. We get cross and we suddenly realise we haven't really forgiven them. So we sigh and forgive them again, saying, right, now that's done, I have forgiven them. But then something else reminds us and we have to start again. We may only have said, I forgive out loud once, but there's been a lot more unspoken forgiving to do. I really like this interpretation because I think it really says something about the complexity of forgiveness. It's not always so straightforward, and it can be very hard to forgive properly. And if that is so, it is hard. We can find ourselves trapped, if we're not careful, into a repetitive loop of resentment, even as we try to forgive. Jesus' outrageous parable of the two debtors can help with this, though, because it reframes everything and it can break this cycle of resentment. It offers us a way out. Because in the story, we are invited to give up playing the tiresome role of the magnanimous but secretly resentful forgiver, and suddenly remember that it is we who are incredibly, unexpectedly, and utterly forgiving. Then, instead of the effort to muster up a feeling we may not really have, we can let the sheer gratitude for our own undeserved release from guilt flow out naturally into release and peace for others. So today's theme is very much forgiveness. And if you are like me, you will occasionally, actually quite often, if I'm honest, say the Lord's Prayer and find yourself at the Amen, having hardly remembered saying Our Father. So let's today, on those two lines, especially when we say the Lord's Prayer, focus on those two lines and ask for God's help to forgive in whatever personal context we may have. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Because forgiving is about the most Christian thing any of us can do. Amen. We now stand to confess our faith in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten of God's made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Please sit or kneel for our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. Let us offer our thanksgiving and prayers as we hold the needs of the church, the world, the community, family and friends before our Lord. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we pray for the worldwide church. Bless our congregation, both here and watching at home, and all congregations around the globe. That as we pray, Lord, your presence can be seen vividly in what we do and say each day. We pray that your joy and your love flow freely in and through us. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Creator God, we pray that all nations of the world, for all who work for peace and unity, for all world leaders, that they will continue to seek an end to the suffering caused by war and violence, injustice and inequality, disease, prejudice, poverty and helplessness, and bring healing to the world. We remember, especially in our prayers today, the people of Ukraine as they seek peace in the face of war, and the people of Libya and Morocco as they seek to rebuild their countries after natural disasters. Lord, in your mercy. We also remember refugees seeking safety in other countries despite the dangers of the journey. Through our prayer, continue to guide those in authority to help with reconciliation amongst all countries. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Almighty God, you created all people and all of creation. We give thanks for the gifts you have given us physically, mentally, and spiritually, for the joy and love within us that we share as your disciples. We give thanks for the gift of human love and for the end of discrimination against people on grounds of their sexuality and sexual orientation. Open our hearts and our eyes to see all communities as you would have us see them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for the work and service of all care homes and day centres for the elderly and those passing through illness, and for the carers and family and friends in their own home. We also pray for those who are now mentioned by name: David and Sonia Parker, Katie and Mark Serker, Sylvie Marquis, Audrey Filsell, Mike and Dan Noel, Arthur Hill, Reg and Marion Huguet, Lorraine Le Gallet, Derek and Debbie Paul, Ruby Atkinson, David Bishop, John and Carol Jornow, Martin Guest, Ray Kitchen, Simon Kinman, Sheila Garnham, and Desi Campbell. Help all to send your comfort in times of need and bless their families and carers. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, we pray for those who have gone before us to rest in your eternal peace. We remember those who have died, and we pray for all those who have been saddened by the death of a loved one. Be with them in their loneliness. Today we give thanks for the lives of Paul Warren, Annette Kathleen Thompson, Jeanette Sarissa Bree, John Alexander Campbell, June Cruikshank. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, as we go out into the world, we pray that we may reflect your love and forgiveness in our families, our church and our communities, so that we as followers of Christ will draw others into your loving care. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
We stand for the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We offer one another a sign of Christ's peace. And I need to announce a hymn because we're missing a verse. So our next hymn, hymn 105, we are omitting verses 4 and 6. 4 and 6. I need some help with that.
Thank you. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us the cup of salvation.
The
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. Source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, at the supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. This bread to share in the body of Christ. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. Keep, O Lord, your church with your perpetual mercy, and because without you our human frailty cannot but fall, keep us ever by your help from all things hurtful, and lead us to all things profitable to our salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be made in sacrifice. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.